Good afternoon, everybody. I would like to welcome you to the fourth webinar, the first scientific one of the quality webinar series organized by EATRIS of the ADVANCE project. My name is Merel Aks. I work for the Eureka Career Center of KU Leuven, and I will be hosting this webinar for you today. This webinar is a co-hosting between KU Leuven and EATRIS. Today, we are very pleased to have Professor Dr. Isabel Huys and Dr. Gilbert Verbeke joining us for this webinar, which focuses on regulatory and clinical aspects of advanced therapy medicinal products, ATMPs. Please note that this session, as well as the questions and answers, is being recorded and will be shared with all participants, as well as the wider public on the website of EATRIS. We have reserved some time at the end of this session for questions. We invite you to write down your questions in the question box in the control panel, as you can see on this screen. If you would like to hide the control panel, you can click on the orange mark on the left-hand side on top of the control panel, so you can have a better view of the PowerPoint. Let me tell you something about ADVANCE. ADVANCE is a 30-month innovative focused learning program for future developers of ATMPs. It consists of e-learning modules, webinars, face-to-face workshops, and it's aimed for at early career biomedical scientists. There are two cycles of the e-learning modules, of the webinars, and of the face-to-face workshops. Here you can see the project partners, EATRIS and Elevate from the Netherlands, KU Leuven and I3H from Belgium, the University of Ljubljana, the Faculty of Pharmacy, the University of Rome, Instituto Superiore di Sanità, and Takis Biotech from Italy. ADVANCE is a project co-funded by the Erasmus Plus program of the European Union. I'm very happy to welcome our both speakers. The first speaker for today is Professor Dr. Isabel Huys. Isabel Huys is a pharmacist and a doctor in pharmaceutical sciences, both obtained at KU Leuven, with further specializations in intellectual property rights and regulatory sciences, LLM in IPR Max Planck Institute in Munich. She's a full-time professor at the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences, as well as a member of the Center for IT and Intellectual Property Law of KU Leuven. Isabel Huys builds out a research program on intellectual property rights, legal and regulatory strategies for drug development at the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. The research program focuses on all types of medicinal products, small molecules, biologicals, and ATMPs. The research aims at proposing guidance for optimal access to medicinal products. The second speaker for today is Dr. Gilbert Verbeke. He studied at Ghent University, KU Leuven, and the Royal Military Academy. As a biomedical biologist, he is more than 30 years active in the field of human cell and tissue engineering and human cell and tissue banking. Gilbert built up, among other things, significant ATMP regulatory experience. He's also involved in the creation of a bacteriophage therapy center at the Queen Astrid Military Hospital in Brussels, Belgium. He obtained his PhD degrees studying the regulatory hurdles and ethical issues related to the reintroduction of natural bacteriophage therapy into Europe. Gilbert is appointed expert advisor to the Belgium Superior Health Council since 2007. He's engaged in several national EU and NATO task groups and advisory committees. He was a scientific cooperator at the Free University of Brussels between 2007 and 2017, and he is still now scientific cooperator at KU Leuven and the Belgian Royal Military Academy. I'm happy to give the microphone now to our first speaker, Professor Dr. Isabel Huys.
Okay. Thank you, Miro, for this very nice introduction. I will tell you more now about the context and also about what we call the regulatory framework of advanced therapy medicinal products. And after me, Gilbert Verbeek will subsequently introduce you to the clinical applications of ATMPs and all its challenges. And he will focus on a particular type of ATMP based on keratinocytes. So I will provide you first with a little context. Advanced therapy medicinal products, so ATMPs, are medicinal products, as the word says, based on cells, tissues, and genes. So we call them somatic cell therapy medicinal products, gene therapy medicinal products, and tissue engineered products. So these medicinal products can be our medicinal products as such, or they can be, ITMPs can be incorporated as an integral part or in one or other medical devices that may be implantable and that may contain viable cells or non-viable cells. And this, the fact that it may be combined with a medical device is also from a legal point of view and from a regulatory point of view, very relevant, as we will see in a moment. These ATMPs have introduced a paradigm shift in healthcare and the way we treat diseases, opening the door for even curing many diseases that were previously untreatable. And you remember the example of BBPA treated with a particular gene therapy, which was treated for a very rare disease. But also in oncology, CAR T-cell therapies produce remarkable clinical results. And these ATMPs are mainly commercialized through companies, mainly pharmaceutical, large pharmaceutical companies or biotechnology companies. Although very challenging and promising, several challenges remain for these ATMPs to become daily practice. Regulatory agencies have implemented the regulatory framework, which is a very complicated web of rules to expedite the development and the approval of ATMPs, and that is what we will look at today. Manufacturing demands specific for ATMPs will be discussed at the webinar on the 8th of June. And the question about the value assessment, so what is the value of such an ATMP, as well as how affordable is it, these expensive breakthrough therapies for healthcare systems, but also for patients, that will be subject of a seminar in September 2020. Since 1970s, hospitals around the globe have been culturing cells and tissues to treat patients. Patients that were in need, and they did this on a tailor-made fashion and under the responsibility of treating physicians in a non-profit setting, for instance, via stem cell transplantations or grafting cell cultures. And in the 90s, all these activities were subject to national legal frameworks, for instance, in Belgium, according to guidelines of Superior Health Council. And these were also covered or reimbursed via national social security systems. Non-profit cell and tissue banks were also established at these hospitals, all subject to hospital inspections and many other rules. In 2010, a European framework became into existence for cells and tissues, established based on directives. And as you know, directives, European directives, need to be translated into national legislations. So the hospitals, but also the industry at that time who became interested, were subject to a patchwork of national legislations. And as well, there were also other guidelines based on good tissue practices launched, for instance, by the EuroGTP. Huge efforts from the industry led them to the establishment of a European regulation. A regulation is always directly applicable in all countries. And the regulation what was established specific for ATMP is called the Advanced Therapy Medicinal Product Regulation, or in short, the ATMP regulation. It was published in 2007 and only entered into effect in 2012, allowing for for-profit pharmaceutical companies to apply for and obtain market authorization for innovative ATMP-based therapies. So cells and tissues, talked about before, became overnight medicinal products, more specifically advanced medicinal products, subject to this ATMP regulation. And when is actually a cell that is labeled as a medicinal product, more specifically as an advanced therapy medicinal product, hence subject to an ATMP regulation? Well, a cell is considered as a medicinal product the moment such a cell is substantially manipulated so that the biological characteristics, the physiological functions, or structural properties relevant for the intended clinical use have been altered, or whether the cell is not intended to be used for the same essential functions in the recipient and in the donor. And as well, if the cell, and this is typical for medicinal products, if the cell is presented as having properties for treating, preventing, or diagnosing a disease through the pharmacological, immunological, or metabolic action of these cells or tissues. Substantial manipulations are not clearly defined in the legislations, but some examples may be genetic modifications of these cells. Manipulations that are not considered as substantial may include, for instance, to do a centrifugation of these cells, soaking them in antibiotic or antimicrobial solutions, sterilizations, irradiation, cell separation, concentrating these cells. All these are considered as not substantial manipulations. If such medicinal product is prepared on an industrial level or with an industrial process and meant to be placed on the European market, the European regulations apply. Is that a problem? Well, if the European regulation applies, this means that this medicinal product needs to follow the path through a preclinical development pathway over a clinical development in order to achieve regulatory approval and ultimately reimbursement before it can reach the patient. And this way is very long and costly, hence mainly led by the industry in these latter costly phases. Aside from several regulations that are applicable, I can show you also some examples of regulations. So some regulations that are applicable, meaning regulations are legislations that are directly applicable in different countries, are related to ATMPs as such, very specifically. For instance, as well, related to the central market authorization, meaning that the European Medicines Agency is responsible for the marketing authorization. There are as well specific regulations related to these medical devices. And then, of course, as we have to do with human biological material and related personal data, the General Data Protection Regulation, so the GDPR, applies. Several other directives are applicable related to cells and tissues, especially the one which is related to medicinal products, so the 2001/83, but also the directives are related to the donor procurement and testing of human cells and tissues. And if these ATMPs are based on blood products, then also these types of regulation directives apply. The European Medicines Agency, EMA, has enacted as well specific guidances for ATMPs and for specific types of ATMPs based on the regulations and the directives talked above. And then indeed we have different national legislations, first translating these directives into national law, but also several additional legislations, for instance, related to biobanking. We have then as well several guides on the quality and on the safety of these tissues and cells, And the European Directorate of Quality of Medicines has also provided guides on good for good tissue practices. So what we see is that indeed several rules need to guarantee the good manufacturing practices, GMP, but also the good clinical practices, GCP, the good tissue practices, GTP, and good pharmacovigilance practices, meaning the follow-up of the safety requirements of these medicinal products, GVP. All these requirements are very relevant and very important and highly strictly regulated in the context of ATMPs. And because we have to do with very expensive investments that are needed in order to build out such an ATMP as a medicinal product, intellectual property rights come into the picture. And patent protection may play a role in terms of incentives for investments. And these intellectual property frames may differ from across between Europe and the US or other places around the world. And indeed, ethical frameworks play as well a role as we deal with human biological material, and we need to respect at any time the principles of human dignity. As this process to make an advanced therapy medicinal product may take long, the European Medicines Agency explores early access programs in its strategic agenda, meaning providing earlier access to these medicines, as patients cannot wait for years until their highly needed treatment becomes available. And one or some of these early access programs are depicted here, for instance, conditional marketing authorization, meaning that the marketing authorization is provided for a medicinal product or an ATMP based on limited data on the condition that additional data will be collected. Compassionate use program as accelerated assessments, meaning that the evaluation will be accelerated and sped up, and medical need programs, some of these are regulated on a national level. And what with the hospitals who use manipulated cells for years on their patients? The legislator recognizes this situation and foresees an alternative route for authorizing ATMPs, the so-called hospital exemption. However, such ATMPs must be produced on a limited scale, on a non-routine basis, under the responsibility and the prescription of a medicinal practitioner, so a physician, for an individual patient. And also here you see that different regulations and directives and national laws and also other guides apply. Even intellectual property frameworks may come into existence, especially in Europe, where you know that indeed the moment human biological material is isolated, several types of intellectual property rights may become possible and available. And here ethical framework, for instance, the Helsinki Declaration, are very important in order to make this happening. So the hospital exemption is in fact an exemption introduced in the ATMP regulation. And this hospital exemption must be authorized by the national competent authorities. So indeed, again, the national legislations become here very relevant. And ATMPs, which are subject to this exemption, must comply with the same national requirements concerning the quality, so the GMP, good manufacturing practice standards, and traceability and pharmacovigilance that apply to the authorized medicinal products. So a clear solution for routine hospital-based applications is not yet found. And colleagues from the hospital, such as Dr. Gilbert Verbeke, who you will hear in a few moments, are exploring other existing frameworks, such as magistral preparations, to address that gap. Does that mean that a cell that is used as such for years in hospitals, not considered as an ATMP, that these cells are out of any legal framework? No. Still, the directives and the regulations, but still the regulation, for instance, on the processing of personal data, the GDPR apply, but also other directives on tissues and cells, even for preservation, manipulation, the storage and the distribution of these cells. And indeed, the national legislations, the different guides on quality and safety, all apply, as well as the intellectual property frameworks and the ethical frameworks. So regulating the world on cells and tissues with the aim of guaranteeing safety, but at the same time also access for patients, is a real balancing exercise. And keeping that balance under control is very challenging. But opportunities for patients should be the main driver. And therefore, I am very happy to give you the word to Gilbert Verbeken to introduce you to the clinical applications of cells and tissues.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for inviting me to share our experience with what's today called ATMPs in our hospital. I just want to say we have two types of cell banks and tissue banks in our hospital, and we have them since 1987. A human skin bank and a human keratinocyte bank. Why these two types of banks historically? Well, skin, we use donor skin for use on our patients, on our patients in the burn unit, but we can derive cells from the skin and then culture them for grafting again on patients. And there we have chosen for one type of keratinocytes. One type we've chosen, keratinocytes, it's one type of epithelial cells, and when you grow them and you graft them, they are not recognized well by the patient's immune system, so they stay longer in the wound bed. They are not rejected immediately. So over time, we've grafted more than 1,000 patients with these types of cells, and that means, and still today, we graft these patients weekly, so we are not exempted from the ATMP regulation today. Because we use in routine these kinds of cultures. And we store them also in liquid nitrogen till we need them for the patients. So at the moment of production, we don't know which patient will get the cells. So two reasons why we cannot be covered by the hospital exemption. It's a medicinal product, and in the past, when these cells were delivered through the cell and tissue bank, it was the medical doctor who was responsible for the cell or tissue bank who delivered the infected cells. Today, they have to be delivered by a hospital pharmacist since it are ATMPs, it are medicinal products. Our bank is also ISO certified, 9001 certified, so defining more or less a detailed quality system that's implemented in our banks. Keratinocyte production. I want to explain a bit the keratinocyte production and use, because when I touch these productions, I can talk about somatic cell therapy, I can illustrate tissue engineering, I can illustrate combined products, but I will not talk about gene therapy product because we are not working on that issue, but it can give you an idea of what ATMP stands for. If we grow keratinocyte sheets, we have to harvest from the donor, the patient himself or the donor skin. So it's a tangential split thickness excision using a dermatome. It's about 0.2, 0.3 millimeter thick, these skin strips. And that we can graft immediately on the patient's burnt wound site. It's called an autograft. The patient is his own donor. Just the skin is replaced to another site of the body. And you don't do anything more with that skin. So this type of skin grafts is, or it's autologous from the patient himself, or it comes as a temporary biological dressing from a donor, an allogeneic donor. And then it's covered strictly by the cell and tissue directive, the European cell and tissue directive, since there are no manipulations. But then we go further and we want to grow keratinocytes. So we have to use enzymes to cut between the epidermis and the epithelium. And already doing that using enzymes puts you in a difficult position. You are in fact already then an ATMP. We also will isolate the cells themselves from the epithelium, individual cells, through enzyme use. We will put them in culture medium and centrifugate them. And we have a lot of different types of cells. We will produce them in a way that by selective media, we will come out with only the keratinocytes, but we grow the cells. So ATMP again. You have also possibilities to mechanically isolate cells and individualize cells. And you could think about structures where you don't grow them. You, for instance, spray them immediately on the patient's wound bed. If you do that, you are not covered by the ATMP, within the scope of the ATMP, because you didn't manipulate in a significant way your cells. So you stay covered then by the cell and tissue directly. What was the evolution in time? We grafted keratinocyte sheet cultures starting from adult donor skin. But since we were working with critical care patients, we were limited in the surface we could culture. From 1 square centimeter of donor skin, adult donor skin, you can only grow 800 square centimeter of culture skin. So we looked for other sources and we ended up with the neonatal foreskin, a newborn child. Sometimes it's circumcised for medical reasons, or it's a deceased, it's a child just deceased after birth, day one after birth. If you take then the foreskin and you start up your productions from that, you can culture 100 square kilometer of skin, culture skin. You can work for years with the same donor. And in fact, you can test the mother for biological safety and not the child. You can, since there is huge capacity of production, create master and cell banks, and you can then test the biological safety much more intensive than what you are obliged to do by law, because you know that once you've tested everything, you can test, work for years with these cells. So it was an observation, but today we know that in fact doing that, we're working with the stem cells present in the neonatal foreskin. It are unipotent stem cells that are doing the job. Enzymatically separation of the cells, centrifugation, and then storage. We don't start the productions because we have to know the results of the biological safety testing, and then we start to grow the cells. They form islands on the bottom of a flask. They become confluent, multi-layered, differentiated, and then we have to find a way out to graft them on the patient. Looks like this to a microscope, but the issue is the last phase of the production is in a peel-off flask. You have a flask with a cover that you can remove, and then you have your cells as a sheet on the bottom of the flask. You use enzymes to just cut between the plastic and the sheet. It comes loose and you can cover it by a dressing, a medical dressing that's already used on burn patients and their wounds. So we make flaps and then we take it out and you have a medical device in effect covered with the epithelial culture sheet. And that means that here you have a combined product. You developed a combined product. It's an ATMP. It's no longer somatic cell therapy product. It's a combined product. And we can store that in liquid nitrogen for later use. What in ATMP development also today is important, I can illustrate it by go through our own historical timeline. We started in 87, just growing cultures and skin from the patient himself for himself. So autologous use, that's what you see in the cell and tissue world today when companies are working with cells and tissues, somatic cell therapies, most of them are autologous. But in our case, when we graft these epithelial sheets in an excised third degree burn wound bed, it's an expensive technique and there is not much take. And if there is take, they come loose again, these sheets, because it's a foreign environment for epithelial cells in a deep third-degree wound bed. So we started to step off the concept of cake in during the following years. We started to grow allogeneic cells, meaning donor cells, cells from deceased donors. We could culture them, we could store them, because the use of autologous cells, you can culture them, but when your cells are ready, perhaps the patient is not ready for surgery, and the other way around, the patient is ready and your cells are not ready. So by working with allogeneic material, phase two then on the slide, you can just culture, store, and then use them when the patient's ready. So we don't have that problem anymore. And we talk then from that time onward stimulating the healing. So we saw that these cells infect, secrete growth factors, give signals to the wound bed. They stimulate the healing, and they do it in the same way as the autologous cells do. So we'll follow that pathway. Then we started cryopreservation optimization, and also during today, even also you have to get rid of during the development of animal components in your production medium as feeder layer cells and whatever. When we started in the time producing, you had to grow, for instance, these epithelial cells on mouse fibroblasts that you have to remove afterwards, or you had to put animal fetal serum in your culture medium to be able to grow the cells. And these are things that today regulators, in fact, don't want anymore. So If you can avoid it, you have to do it, and that's what we did over time. So we are now growing in defined mediums and our three components. We are confirm the cell and tissue directives. We are implementing now the AMP issues, and we are ISO certified. Indications for use is another issue. If a company develops ATMPs today, they will very well know what their target is, for which type of patients, what indication. They will run clinical trials, and then when the product goes to the market, it has to be used in those type of indications, of course. So you have to do another trial, or you are working out of label, out of label use. So historically, if you do the clinical development in a hospital without company involvement and on a non-profit basis, we just use the sheets where we think they are interesting to use. For instance, as I said, on burnt surfaces, you take the patient's own skin graft, autograft, you make mesh holes. I'll explain later what that is. You make holes, in fact, that it becomes a fishnet. You can cover larger surfaces, and you put your sheets on top, and they stimulate the healing of the wound, of the holes. And it's important, because if you survive admission in the critical burn care, when you die during the process, the weeks after, it's because of microbiological infection most of the time. So closing of the wound is very important. And we also graft donor sites, where we take the patient's own healthy skin, has to heal again. It's a split thickness skin graft that's put on another part of the body. We cover that also with the epithelium cells to stimulate the healing so that it can be harvested more times and quicker. We've also seen if, for instance, chronic otorrhea, you can, for instance, have an eardrum transplantation, and there exists a problem in a lot of times that the skin of the patient doesn't cover the new tympanum, and then you have a leaking ear for years. If you graft keratinocytes on top, 70% of them heal, and that's the same with ulcers, chronic ulcers, for instance, venous ulcers. 60% of these heal when you graft them with your sheets. What we also do, keratinocyte application, is try to prevent surgery, especially in the face, for instance. If we are not sure that you have a deep second degree and that could heal from itself, or a third degree that will never heal from itself, if you are doubts, also there we use these sheets to cover the wound, to stimulate, and to see what happens. Perhaps it heals from itself and we don't have surgery. And we do the same thing on children. Children have a much stronger healing potential than adults. Some depth of the wounds that would never heal with adults can heal with children when children are grafted with the sheets, with the epithelial sheets. Over time, I say, if ATMP, different indications, different trials, different products, complicated industrial approach, but also this example, over time, you also use the patient, and we are still using the patient as his own incubator. We take a double setting, in one of them a solution with the cells, the culture cells, individualized again. The other one, fibrin glue, that makes the cells stick to the wound bed, and it grows on the patient, and we also use that for irregular surfaces that have to be grafted with cells. Again, it are the same keratinocytes, it are other products, and in the pharmaceutical framework, another product, another clinical. To explain the use and the terminology, this is the autograft, the healthy skin is taken, the wound bed itself, the burnt wound bed is excised, still bleeding surface. You make a fishnet, 1, 2, 3, for instance, means mesh 1, 2, 3, that you can cover 3 times the larger surface than the initial surface of the place where the graft was taken, and that you cover with the keratinocyte sheets to let them heal quicker, as you can see here. The keratinocytes were grafted in this regio. You can also use larger meshes, healing also, that normally that wouldn't heal, but in this case, covering them with keratinocytes, it heals. But there is a wafer pattern in the end, so aesthetically it's not optimal. We don't do that anymore. And sometimes, but that's patient dependent, you also see scar prevention combining with epithelial cells. Problem with moving the slides. Here is an example of an ulcer, chronic venous ulcer. You can start grafting it. It has been like that for years. And then you see again its stimulation that place. You have to reapply again and again every few weeks a sheet that you graft, and it ends up with the healed wound. Skin equivalent development. We are also involved in, and then you have the third type of ATMP I wanted to discuss. It's a tissue engineered product. We take the cryopreserved human allogeneic donor skin that's in our liquid nitrogen tanks present, and we take out all the cells and all the debris so that we only keep the structure of the skin, only the structure of the dermis, the collagen and the elastin, and that you can graft as a matrix, as a scaffold, onto the patient, and it will stay there because it's not recognized by the patient's immune system. So you can try to create, starting from that, permanent skin equivalent. It's not on the market today, it doesn't exist. There are no dressings or whatever with that name that can replace all the skin's functions. So we think when we can upload these scaffolds with cells, we can have permanent skin equivalent that can be based on the patient. The first approach is putting the scaffold on the patient and then spray the patient's own autologous cells on the graft. And then they grow in and they can develop different types of cells. That's one approach. The second one is in the depth of the wound bed, we take fat and we graft these cells on top of these meshes of these scaffolds. And we are sure then that part of these adipose cells, fat cells, are stem cells. They can then develop in different cell types and close the wound permanently. So that means that you have developed a tissue engineered. A practical example, and I know it's an issue, how do you develop ATMPs and in what frame, and how do you develop hospital-based products? When you develop ATMPs from an industrial point of view, it's clear. It's clear and defined what the pathway is that you have to follow with clinical trials, proving efficacy, go to for marketing authorization, and so on and so on. When you're confronted in a hospital in a non-profit setting with a patient, then you use all the tools you have, and I can illustrate you here. It's not evident. You cannot talk about marketing authorization pathways. You don't have time for years. And I'll give an example of one patient, 9 years old, 95% burned. But his face was not burned, and we thought if we can try to let heal the wounds, he still has a future. So we started for the autograph that I have explained with the holes. That's one thing. So that's today still tissue bank covered by the cell and tissue directive if it's an allograft. But this is an autograft. You start grafting the wounds with the remaining skin, donor skin from himself. It's an autograft. But where you don't have skin anymore, you have to cover with donor skin allografts temporarily. You will remove it later to replace again with autografts when the donor sites are healed. This is still today then the classical allogeneic donor skin, and it's covered by the cell and tissue directive. But in practice, if you have the patient, you use other techniques, Meek-Wall techniques. You make stamps of donor skin from himself. You put it on the wound bed. You spray with cells. You take skin from the skull or the feet where it's still present, and you stimulate with autologous cells, but also you spray with autologous cells, the patient's own cells, so that they can stick and that they can also support the healing. So you do these things, and imagine you have to put different products like that on the market from a non-hospital framework. A non-profit hospital framework is impossible. Only for preparing the environment in which we can work with these ATMPs today, we had to invest 5 million euros in clean rooms and so on. And that's about the limit from what we could do. But imagine you have to go with each product for each indication. For marketing authorization, you're talking about 10 years or more and dozens of millions of euros. So making the products also very expensive. So the patient then survived. Now, how can we get out of this frame? Because I said we cannot work on the hospital exemption because we do it in routine and so on and so on. And we thought, since ATMP is part of the medicinal product legislative frame, there is an exemption in the classical pharmaceutical framework, medicinal product framework, that's a provision for products that don't need marketing authorization. And if you don't need marketing authorization, what type of products are that? For instance, the magisterial preparations. And the magisterial preparation says that you work for a specific patient on prescription of a medical doctor, and that your final product is compiled and delivered by a hospital pharmacist. And that are pathways we are investigating now. We are in permanent discussion with competent authorities in our country to see if that's feasible for ATMPs in hospitals where they work non-profit for their own patients. So working for out of the scope effect of the marketing authorization pathway. And also we gained legal advice in the time discussing the issue. If you stay in your hospital with your own productions on your own patients, in fact, do you do market placement? Is that market placement? Do you need a marketing authorization then? In our eyes, it's not a market placement. We don't do this distribution, but that approach was not, or that reflection was not followed by the regulators. So we still try to find the magisterial solution. So that's why I wanted to give to you as a message. I think other questions, but then I give over to the organizers again.
There are a couple of questions. I will read out the first question. Does the sheet only contain keratinocytes or also other differentiated cells? This is a question by Santoshi.
The keratinocyte sheets are exclusive keratinocytes, and all the selection, the medias are specifically selection media for getting at the end only the keratinocytes. And historically, we never wanted to have, for instance, Langerhans cells in them because they are recognized by the immune system, and then the rejection is quick.
Okay, thank you. Then there is another question. After storage, the properties of the lab-produced skin remain the same. What process do you use to store? Do you add any supplements? This is a question by João Pedro. Yes.
It depends if you're talking about the cultures or the skin grafts. The skin grafts, they are stored in a concentration of glycerol, which is a cryoprotective. And the cryoprotective that stores the keratinocyte sheets or the cells is dimethylsulfoxide. And then in the time we let investigate by an external laboratory how many DMSO could go to the patients without problems, and then we know that we can, for instance, graft. Maybe wash the sheets before grafting, and we can graft 20 sheets in one. So we investigated the issue of the present dimethylsulfoxide.
Thank you. Another question by the same person. Is there a minimum age to use ATMP? This ATMP is as effective when comparing young people to elderly people.
The experience we have is on the burn wounds. We see that the healing potential of young people is much higher than adult people, but there is no minimum age for use. There is no minimum age for we don't select based on the age which patient will get which age.
Okay. Despite another question, despite the great promise of that ATMPs represent for patients, there are only 11 that have ME. What can recruiters do to help more products get over the line and to the patients? Should they work more closer with investigators to develop better potency assays and avoid common mistakes?
Yes, I think that's already a very good suggestion. Indeed, that number of advanced therapies, medicinal products received authorization, that does even not mean that these therapies are available on the market, because indeed, further on, they also need to get reimbursement. And because these are so expensive, many of these products, even if they are authorized, and we also see indeed that we have just a few authorized, they even do not reach the patients due to these market access issues. And we will talk about this more in depth in the webinar in September. But indeed, what can we do in order to foster that track? And collaborations, as you said, indeed, between the profit and the non-profit sector in public-private partnerships are happening, and these are also aimed at sharing risks and also indeed sharing investment needs. This may have an influence indeed on the business model then related to these ATMPs when they are co-developed between profit and non-profit sector. And the ATMP regulation already has introduced certain incentives for small and medium-sized enterprises, so small companies, relieving them from expensive scientific advice fees. So I think indeed a revision of these incentives might also be a good way. And experience
can to be built. Can I add something?
Yes.
I also think there is a very close contact that's necessary between the non-profit hospital setting and the industry who wants to develop ATMPs. And I think that it's important that the first phases can be developed in hospitals, and then when you see some safety and efficacy, that then industry perhaps takes over. But for sure, for instance, in Belgium, and I think in other countries also, it's a problem for hospitals that you have the European hospital exemption patchwork, because if you are working on the hospital exemption structure, you cannot use your data for filing for marketing authorization. it's not considered. This type of documentation as clinical trials and so on, so it can be possible that you collect a lot of data, that you see efficacy, that then there is a spin-off and it goes to industry, but then industry has to start all over again with clinical trials and everything, because you cannot use the hospital data for the documentation in your marketing authorization.
Yeah, and I think as well close interaction with the regulators up front, like what they call early interactions or early dialogues, might also be very good. There are opportunities at the European Medicines Agency for applicants and for developers to interact with them, to ask for guidance on how to proceed and about expectations and about, for instance, also technical aspects like how to design the clinical trials in a context where you only have a very few patients in a very complicated setting. So early interactions with these with the regulators might also help here.
Okay, thank you. The next question, is there a European body regulating the implementation of the ATMP's directives in the countries?
So the European body regulating the implementation. So no, it's up to each and every individual country to translate the directives which are enacted on a European level, to translate these into their own national legislation. So what happens is that the idea and the concepts within these directives remain the same, and actually the ultimate result of the directives need to be the same. So that's the harmonizing purpose of directives. However, countries may introduce particularities about how they interpret that particular directive. They may even introduce more stringent rules within their national framework. So the harmonizing effect, if you want, and the difference between directives and regulations on the European level remains and is very clear and indeed has a huge effect.
Can I add something there? Because if you're talking then for ATMP regulation, how it works in practice is if I want our keratinocytes, for instance, if you want to go to the market with them, then it has to be classified, evaluated whether what you are doing is an ATMP product production. So you have to submit your file to a European Commission, the Commission for Advanced Therapy, and they give then advice to EMA. And when you're classified as an ATMP, then you know what pathway to follow. And if they say no, it remains under the cell and tissue directive, yeah, then you're exempted from the ATMP. But there is at the European level, it exists, the CAT, the Commission for Advanced Therapy.
Thank you. Next question then. From a regulatory perspective, what is the main hurdle for cell therapies such as CAR-Ts having the same success in solid tumors as they have had in hematological cancers?
I'm just wondering whether we understand well the question. Is it from a clinical point of view that you are asking for what type of data is missing? And so because what the regulators are often confronted with is lack of data, of enough convincing data, because what regulators at the European Medicines Agency and indeed the Commission on Advanced Therapies, the CAT, need to do is to consider all the data that has been gathered on this cell-based products, so this ATMP. And this is data on preclinical research, but also on clinical research on patients. And very often, advanced therapy medicinal products address rare diseases. So, and they cannot conduct a large-scale, randomized, controlled trials with including thousands of patients, because these ATMPs very often are directed to very small size patient populations. And so what regulators are confronted with is having an ATMP in front of them that they need to assess based on very limited clinical data. and that they at the same time need to evaluate the safety, the efficacy, and the quality of the product. And how can they do this if there is if the patient population, for instance, is very small, or if the data are not really convincing, but at the same time, there is nothing, no other treatment available for these patients. So that's really a challenge that is, the challenge that the regulators are confronted with.
Thank you. Next question. Quite often, investigators start any cultures with including serum, and sometimes when you start to change it into a translational product, one needs to change into a serum-free product or a chemically defined product. But many times this results into failure. Shouldn't the investigator start thinking about this upfront?
Yeah, that's what I tried to touch when I gave the overview over time. It's very important that you reflect at the beginning of what you're doing, what will complicate your marketing authorization when you have a final product. For instance, in the case of serum replacement, we have supplements now that have nothing to do with serum, and you use it and you know you will not end up with problems at the end. And the same at the start of your logic when you use animal cells is the same, or feeder layers. And we have to not only at how you produce and what you use, but also about your target population. Is it worth, if you do research, shouldn't you reflect in the beginning of your before the start even about what is your target population? What will the final product cost? Is there a paying party for that? You should talk with all stakeholders and then launch your research projects when it's worthwhile doing it from a company point of view. And then, of course, you can say that industry will be cherry picking. They will only do the things that are interesting for them at a commercial level, but gives also opportunities then for working with the rest through the hospital systems.
Thank you. Next question. How would you design the clinical trial in later phases as the autograft is autolog and personalized?
I'm not sure I understand the question very well. Can you repeat it?
How would you design the clinical trial in later phases as the autograft is autolog and personalized?
You mean the skin equivalent I proposed, the last slides, the tissue engineered product?
I'm not sure what this person is referring to.
I'll give a general answer. It depends. An autograft is an autograft. You don't have to do anything. It's a surgical technique. If you load it up with the patient's own cells that are not cultured, then you're talking about surgical technique in one movement. You don't need anything extra except, of course, the consent of the patient. If you start to grow the patient's cells, you end up in the field of ATMPs, and you have to set up clinical trials then because it's an ATMP. And it's a huge issue because for putting these products in a trial, for instance, these cells, they have to be GMP produced. You leave the world of cell and tissue directives. Yeah, you need a GMP produced investigation medicine product. So for hospitals, it's not doable, such a thing. And that's why we try, as I said in the beginning, we will leave the field again when we compile the skin equivalent structures on the scaffolds. We will try to separate the cells mechanically. We will try not to grow them up, but spray them immediately on the scaffolds in the wound bed, and we let them grow themselves. And then we stay in the field of surgical technique, and we don't have to follow the marketing authorization clinical trial process for LVM. Mm-hmm.
The person who asked this question, Gilbert, added that she meant, how would you design personalized ARMPs in later phases?
Isabel, do you have an answer to that? Because it's a difficult one for me.
Maybe it's ARNB. I think it's about risk management plans. I am not sure whether that is the case. Whether it is about designs of clinical trials, indeed, there are different ways of designing a clinical trial. As I told you, the gold standard are these randomized clinical trials, controlled, blinded with a control arm. But as in many cases, such large populations are not ready, single arm trials or many other types of trials. And even if you talk about personalized medicine, then you also have other types of designs that are applicable, but not always very convincing and producing convincing evidence for the regulators. And indeed, people, our clinicians, are now looking for optimal designs for clinical trials in order to overcome this problem, because you cannot augment or increase the population. We are looking, or they are looking at how to improve that evidence collection via the clinical trial designs.
Okay, thank you. Another
answer maybe to that is that indeed, if you talk about this follow-up, it might be important to, and even a condition, that the moment an ATMP has been approved, a clear follow-up of the use of that ATMP in clinical practice is done, and that the real-world use, so the real-world evidence, will be collected, and then also systematically analyzed and looked at in order to guarantee whether the efficient efficacy and safety of that medicinal product remain valuable and applicable.
Thank you. Then a last question. Should the regulators and researchers be in better contact from an earlier stage in ATMP development rather than later to eliminate common mistakes that cost time and money? How do you suggest that this could be done outside of an innovation task force or an expensive scientific advice?
I can talk just about the Belgium situation because we were involved in it and confronted with it, but competent authority in Belgium, they give free advice on this type of questions. They resemble experts, and you can ask for scientific and regulatory advice without much cost.
Yeah, and another opportunity is created by these public-private partnership platforms of the Innovative Medicines Initiative, the IMI, where pharmaceutical companies and non-profit entities such as hospitals, but also patient organizations, regulators such as the EMA, FDA, but also national agencies and health technology assessment bodies, HTA, and payers, come together. And if the IMI has a call on advanced therapies, which they have, you may look it up on their website, well, then they create a platform that everybody comes together, shares knowledge, exchange views, and also objectives to the field forward in that direction, especially in early phases.
Okay. Thank you very much, Isabel and Gilbert, for your nice presentations. Thank you to the audience also for listening and also for your attention and your interesting questions. Please follow us on LinkedIn or Twitter or via our website. As I told you in the beginning of the webinar, this recording of this webinar will be made available on the EATRIS website. You will also all receive the handouts and the recording, as well as an evaluation form. It would be interesting for us if you can fill this in. And then we would like to invite you for the next webinar, which will be on ATMP manufacturing. Which will be held on Monday, June 8, also at 1 p.m. Thank you all for listening, and have a very nice day. Goodbye.